Travis, but we go a ways back. Maybe you won't smack me in the head. So where are you from?
Born in Walnut, Mississippi. Moved to Memphis, Tennessee when I was probably about 4 or 5 years old. My parents moved up there. I grew up in Memphis, Tennessee. Went to high school there and worked in the studios in Memphis. High Studios, American Studios, Sonic Studios, Sun Studios, Philips Studios. And I had a career in guitar instrumentals when I was 16 years old. Had a hit record called Scratchy. And had about 9 other instrumentals chart. And I wanted to be a singer, which I sung back then, but the guy that was producing me, who was the top guitar player in Memphis that played on all the Sun records, Roland James, and he had a studio he'd opened up, so I went over there. I was 16, and I went over there, and I had my own style, and taught myself, and I was cocky, and I went in there, and I told him, I said, I want to be your session guitar player. And he said, well, Travis, he said, I've seen you sing back when you were 11, 12, but I had never heard you play guitar. He said, bring your guitar in, let me hear you play a little bit. So I played him some stuff, and he said, he can play. He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a session next week, and I want you to come try out for it. So I went and played on it, and he said, I'm going to start using you. So I started playing on the sessions, and I let him hear some of my songs vocally, and he said, I like him. He said, but your voice hadn't changed. He said, you sound like a young Brenda Lee. And
he said, what's wrong with that?
He said, you got some instrumentals, you said. And I said, yeah, I got some instrumentals. So I played him some of the instrumentals. He said, now, that's what I want to record. So what he would do to kind of, I guess, pacify me, we'd put an instrumental out on one side. He'd let me do one of my vocals on the other side, the B side. And we did an instrumental that I had written called Scratchy. And I built me a distortion unit, a fuzz tone, and we did reverse tape in the middle of the thing, which was, I've been told since then, that was the first record that, before the Beatles, that had reverse tape on the same thing we're doing.
Yeah.
So we started shopping it around, trying to get a deal on it, and back then, Chet Atkins was an A&R man at RCA Victor, so we sent it to him. And this was before email and all that. He sent us a letter back, and it said, "This scares me. I pass." So Roland James, he said, "Well, I'll tell you what. I've got me a label. I just started. We're gonna put it on my label." And he said, "We're gonna try to create a demand." He said, "We're gonna hit all these radio stations around Memphis, as if we get them playing it, we can force these big stations to go on it." So that's what we did. We got it going. We got number one in Memphis, and then we went to Birmingham, Atlanta. And after Atlanta, we'd sold about 100,000 records. Well, Atlantic Records called, Jerry Wexler called. So we did a lease deal with them, distribution deal with them. So from then on, my other records came out. They were on Atlantic. There was two English guys, Peter and Gordon, Peter Asher and Gordon Waller. They had a record that was hitting over in Europe called World Without Love. And they had Scratchy was happening over there, and so they called my booking agent, and they said, we want Travis Wammack's band to back us on our USA tour. So they came over, and we flew to New York. I had never been out of Memphis, never been on a plane, scared to death. Got up there and got New York, boy, that was really scary. And we played the World's Fair. That was our first concert with them. And it went over good. Peter Asher was a good harmony singer, and Gordon Waller was okay, but they had kind of lucked up on the song World Without Love. At the time, Peter Asher's sister, Jane Asher, was going with Paul McCartney. So Paul McCartney had written this song, so he gave it to Peter Asher. He said, here's y'all a song to record. And of course, the Beatles was just really hot as a firecracker right then. So World Without Love, with the help of Paul McCartney writing it, and going with Jane Asher, Peter's sister, that's how the Capitol Records picked up on it. So we were touring all over. And I had the record Scratchy, the other side of the record was a real fast guitar instrumental called Firefly. And that was what I thought was the hit. And I told him, I said, this is the hit, you know. So we were playing, and Roland James come, and he said, we've got a hit. I said, really? And he said, yeah, Scratchy. I said, Scratchy? He said, yeah. Keep playing Firefly, because it shows your speed, but Scratchy is a hit. I said, okay. So we were scheduled to play Chicago. We got to the hotel. I got a call from the top DJ back then, and I listened to him in Memphis. He was like, WLS, you could pick that station up everywhere. And the DJ was called, his name was Art Roberts. He said, Travis, it's Art Roberts. He said, I heard you're on the show, Peter Gordon. He said, is there any way I can get you to play Scratchy? He said, World Without Love is number two this week on WLS. I said, great. He said, Scratchy's number one. I said, well, I can work something out. We can negotiate. I didn't let him know that I was already open and doing a 15-minute set. So he paid me extra bucks. So from then on, I would call ahead of the towns that we played, and I'd book myself on the thing and make a little extra money. And I wrote two songs for him that was on one of their albums, Two Little Lovebirds, My Little Girl's Gone. All this stuff's going on when I was like 16 and 17 years old.
Wow.
It was really just an unbelievable feeling to be driving along and hear my Scratchy playing over in, you know, Arizona or somewhere, you
yeah.
know, or used to hear old Wolfman Jack play it, you know. And
wow.
So Rick Hall came to Memphis, Tennessee, and at a club, heard me, and he tried to get me to move down to Muscle Shoals. And I had a thing going on at American with Tommy Cogbell, and I told him, I said, well, I'll think about it. So after about 2 years, I finally made the move. He kind of, as old saying goes, he made me an offer I couldn't refuse, so I moved to Muscle Shoals. But previously, he had been flying me down. I'd been playing on the records there at Fame for 2 years before I moved down, which I didn't get any credit for, because I asked the secretary, I said, how come my name's not on any of these albums? And she said, Rick says Memphis is competition to Muscle Shoals, and you're from Memphis. I said, well, there's a lot of other Memphis people playing this stuff. And she said, yeah, but you're known, and they're not, so blah, blah, blah. So I moved down, and lo and behold, I started getting my name on them records and everything. And I did two albums at Fame and probably 10 or 12 singles. Had two top 40 hits there. And we did an album in 1969. Little Richard started back doing rock and roll, and he came to Fame Studios. And he recorded one of my songs that I'd written called Greenwood, Mississippi. And a Real Thing album was the name of it, and it became it got the charts. He had two singles off of it. So I didn't hear from him until 1984. I got a call one day. My wife said, you got a call? I said, well, we're recording. She said, well, he says he's Little Richard. So I picked the phone up, and I knew right off it was Little Richard. I Travis always does a little bit.
And
so he said, thinking about starting back doing rock and roll, I want you to put me a good southern rock and roll band together. And so I did, and we started touring, went all over the world with him, did a lot of the top TV shows, Arsenio Hall, Smothers Brothers. And 1993, I developed a fear of flying. I just scared me to get on the plane anymore, so I quit him and started pushing my own career again, and doing my own CDs. Me and Donnie Gullett, we formed partnership and selling my CDs on the internet, and I was on five major record labels when I was at Fame, but I'm doing better now with my own label, Snake Man Records, and selling my CDs on CD Baby and the internet and Alabama Music Hall of Fame and the different venues that we play. Is that enough? Y'all need more.
Yeah,
and I'm proud to say that I even played on a bunch of Percy records back at Broadway.
I'm glad to have you, too.
You were talking about that reverse part in Scratchy.
Yeah.
What does that say?
It's an English saying. It's over there, they got a thing. If they like something, they'll say, capital, do that again. You know. And so that's what we said, capital, do that again.
And then reversed.
And we reversed it.
The words, well,
yeah, and it was really ironic because Roland James spliced the tape, we're say that, and then he reversed it and put it there. So a lot of the DJs said, we know how to do this. So they put it on tape, and they reversed that other side, But when they reverse it, it becomes the first side. Capital do it again, and that was reversed. So it blew their mind.
You got the show coming up this weekend with all the old 60s rockers
from
the area.
It's going to be a great show.
It's going to be fun.
David's getting some fantastic response. And, of course, Percy, he is kind of a homecoming for Percy here, and he's going to be up there tearing the walls down.
All you guys around, then, I don't know, just getting no butterflies.
That's right. It's just like you putting your arm around your wife when you
got
to wear the same. Well,
and boy, she sang.
Yeah, what she said just
made her feel relaxed, you know. She was shaking, and
did
I just put my arms around.
Did you tell him that story?
When it happened, I was playing in South Africa at Cape Town, and one of the big, theaters. And Rosette went downtown early that day and got us some African outfit, dashikis and stuff. You know. So she was sitting backstage, and she stuck her leg out from behind the curtain. And I looked back and I saw that big pretty legs thing like that with that split up there. So when I got ready to sing Come Softly to Me, I said, ladies and gentlemen, I said, I'm going to see if I can get my lovely wife, Miss Rosa Slade, to come out here and help me sing this next song. You saw that leg start
pull it back in behind the curtain.
She was hiding, huh?
Well, she came on out and... that's when she started singing. We've been singing together now for over 20 years.
That's the first time she came out and
first
sang
time.
With you?
First time. And listen, we never even rehearsed together or sung together. It was just natural.
Wow.
But she loved Come Softly to Me, so.
I saw her sing with you out at the Hall of Fame a few years back, and your daughter got up and sang, too.
Mm-hmm. Santa Rita,
that was really cool. Travis, what kind of advice you got for the young, upcoming, aspiring musicians besides don't do it?
I would say if somebody wants to be a musician, get in a room and forget about all these videos and stuff that you can copy everything these people are doing and teach yourself. Do your own thing. You know, I have a lot of people ask me, what do you think about all these young players? And I say, well, they are great. Fantastic. I mean, they are. But they don't have a style. You can put 50 of them in a room, turn the light out, let each one play a solo. You can't tell them apart. Back when we were growing up, we didn't have the music colleges to go to. We didn't have me. I didn't have nobody to copy me. I was one of the first to play rock and roll and the way I play it. So I've learned from the heart, not the chart. And I've got a style. I mean, if you hear me, that's Travis Long. And same way with Max and his blues sound. The young kids today, it's too easy for them. Mm-hmm. I mean, they can burn a guitar up or a keyboard or whatever, but they don't have a style that would separate them to where I think would give them a plus on trying to get a record deal or something happening. I mean, mm-hmm. He's different. I mean, when you hear that guy, there's very few of them out there.
And you know, there's so many beautiful things about Muscle Shoals and with my career also, because I was a singer that sung mostly Wilson Pickett, James Brown, Otis Redding. And when I told Quinn Ivey about this poem, about this melody that I had, that Why Did You Leave It, Baby? And change it to When a Man Loves a Woman. Mm-hmm. Well, now Muscle Shoals made me find my way because I was singing like other people.
Yeah.
And so I found exactly who I really, really am when I was discovered by
creating your own style.
Yes, creating mm-hmm. my own style. I heard what you said just now, about the young people.
Yep.
So it's a good thing when they can do their own thing,
And, a lot of people... who was it that wanted to hear you sing that high note?
High note.
The high note. You and Gomer Pyle.
Oh, Gomer. He's talking about Jim Nabors.
Yeah.
We was at Ralph Emery's show in Nashville. And we was in the green room. So Jim come up to me and he say, ain't you that fella that sang that real high song, that high note called When a Man Loves a Woman? I said, oh, yeah. I said, that's me. I say, April 1, I'm Percy Sledge. So he got me. He said, look here. He said, will you sing that note for me right now? I just want to look at your face and hear you sing that note right now. Would you please do it? I said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I said, I'll hit that note for you if you talk to me the same way that you talk on Andy Griffith. He said, oh, I'll do that. I said, when I may, he said, golly.
That's funny. Oh, man. All right. Appreciate y'all.
Yeah.
Good luck with the weekend and the albums and everything. Everybody be sure and check it out.
The new CD's coming out, the show this weekend. And Percy, where are they going to be able to, or Travis, where are they going to be able to purchase these CDs? Are they going to be an iTunes item only? Are they going to be on store shelves? Or
CDs you're talking about?
Yes, sir.
The new thing we're
mm-hmm.
I don't know, you had to ask David. I don't know
okay.
what channels David's going to do on
that. But yeah, all right, so. I'll try to post that on there, ask him and but see where they're at.
It's going to be awesome. I mean, this is Percy's first gospel CD, and he's singing good. He's got a good vocal coach.
Yeah.
All right. We appreciate the time and the interview. Thank you, Max. Thank you, everybody, for coming out to us. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.